how are y'all? We are finally back in semester. Oh my goodness, it has only taken us like all the holidays and all the weather events that we could ever possibly have to get back here, right? But we are finally back, and I am so glad to be back in semester. What happens to me, I don't know about you, when we get away from other believers is that my life kind of goes wacky, you know, and everything goes kind of out of sorts. And then when I'm able to come back with other believers, I get to get back in rhythm, right? And holidays do that to me, weather events do that to me, and maybe just life does that to me. But hopefully, when you are here, you will make some connections that will help you, because I have connections now outside of Real Women from the women here that I actually, even when we're not meeting, I'm able to meet with them for lunch, and I'm able to call them, and we're in groups together, and we're online together, and we're able to keep each other, our friendships kind of going outside of Real Women. That's one of our goals here, is to make opportunity for you to be able to make connections with other women. We cannot make your friends for you, right? That's not possible. But what we can do is provide an environment where you can jump out there and make a friend, okay? So I'm going to encourage you this semester to be bold. Like if you've been coming for a while and you hadn't made any relationships yet, that might be on you, okay? So you got to jump in there and you got to step out there and say hello and ask somebody for their number or whatever, so that you can have a coffee date or have your kids play together or whatever, so that you can have some real godly relationships and friendships. And so try to do that this semester. I know it's tough, but you can do it, right? You can jump out there and make those relationships. And so who am I? If I haven't met you yet, I'm Stacy Harness. I know we have a bunch of new people here tonight. Super excited about that. I am the pastor's wife here of that church if you don't attend here, which is always fine. If like you don't attend here on Sunday, that's totally fine. And you can invite your friends that don't attend here on Sunday, okay? If they don't have a Bible study to come to, invite them to come because we love that. We love sharing community with all types of people and from all different backgrounds and from all different places. And so we would love to have that. And we have six kids together, me and Scott, and we have six grandkids now. And that's the bomb. Like anybody that knows, knows, right? Grandkids are the bomb. And so, but I lead Real Women here at that church. We also have, I kind of lead the Sherwood and help with the Cabot. And we have a Cabot campus as well that actually is meeting tonight in Real Women as well there at a separate location. And so that's really cool. We love that. But what is Real Women? Why do we exist? We exist to be able to make Jesus known everywhere. That's what that church is about. Through relationships with each other and a deeper relationship with God. And so that's the two things we're trying to do. We're trying to grow closer together this way, horizontally, and we're trying to grow closer together vertically with God, okay? And so that's what our goals are here. And we do that by being super real, okay? So when you walk in and you see all different types of people from all different types of backgrounds, we should have all different types of stories, right? And we should be able to share those stories with each other without any fear of judgment or hate or any of those things. We should be able to share what God has done in our life, and maybe we share some of the mistakes we've made so that maybe somebody else doesn't have to stump their toe like we did, right? And so we learn by one of two things. Scott always says we learn by wisdom or we learn by consequences. And believe me, I would much rather learn by the first, right? Much rather learn by wisdom than by consequences. And so if we can share our wisdom with each other, let's do it, right? Let's be real. Nobody here is perfect. We've pretty much figured that out already, right? And so let's share who we are and what God has done in our life, and maybe even our mistakes and our struggles so that we can help one another. And that's what Real Women is really about, is just about being real and letting God work. And so this semester, what are we going to talk about this semester? We're going to be talking about acting like a real woman, okay? And you may ask yourself, and hopefully you will during this semester, what does a real woman act like? And I looked around as I was kind of studying for this. I was like, what does the world think that a real woman is like? And maybe we hear this all the time. Maybe we think that if you are a certain body type, you're a real woman. Or maybe we think that if you have that job where you've achieved a lot, oh, she's a real woman. She's achieved all these things. Or maybe we think if you have a bunch of kids, oh, whoa, she's a real woman. Or maybe we think if you have that special relationship, oh, she's a real woman. Or maybe if you're like on Instagram, you're like, oh, she's an influencer. She's a real woman, you know. Or maybe if you're on TikTok, I don't even know what that is all about. But I don't even know what kind of woman is on that. But there's all these different types of women, and media influences all that, right? And media tells us who we ought to be and what we ought to look like and makes us feel bad about ourselves or good about ourselves. But really, we don't want to be at the whim of every single thing that comes along, right? I don't want to find out if I'm a woman of character by TikTok or by Instagram. I want to find out if I'm a woman of character and how God wants me to act by His word, right? Because that's truth. All these other things are going to come and go, and they're going to blow in and blow out. But you know what? God's word has been the same for years and years and years, and I can trust that. And so that's what we want to learn this semester, is how to act like a real godly woman. And remember that acting like something, we want to be real when we do that. And the way that we are real and the way that we act, the reason we do that is because of what Christ has done for us. Remember, acting is not so that God will love us, because He already does. I don't have to earn that. But when we accept Christ as our Savior, when we accept the gift that He's given us, in light of that gift, we ought to act more like Christ, right? So don't get it confused this semester when we're talking about, you know, you got to be good, you got to be this way, you got to be this character, you got to act like this so that God will love you. That is not what we are saying. We are saying that God loves you, and in light of the fact that He sent His Son to die for me, I should want to act more like Christ so I can show that to other people so they will want the gift that God has given me and them, right? And so don't get that confused this semester. Remember the order, right? God loves me, I accept His gift, and then in light of that, I act a certain way more like Christ, okay? All right, so tonight, we're going to talk about this semester about three different women from the Bible, okay? And we're going to look at the character and why they're probably in the Bible, all right? Now, remember, not a perfect woman in this room exists, and not a perfect woman in the Bible exists, okay? So you will see, from women in the Bible, you will see their struggles, and then you will see some of the character that God wants you to see, that He wants you to try to emulate to be more like Him, okay? So every woman of the Bible, we're not looking at these women going, oh, wow, they're so perfect and we're so bad, okay? We're looking at these women to say they had these struggles, just like I have these struggles, and they were able to do something and have some type of character that God wants me to see that they had that I can emulate in my life as I walk with Him, okay? Because of His strength, I can do these things. And so we're going to talk tonight about one woman in particular, and we've already kind of watched the video on that. We're going to talk about Ruth. And it's a book in the Bible. If you're not familiar with it, I would encourage you to take some time to read through it. Short read, but absolutely some amazing information. And we're going to talk about the loyalty of Ruth, okay? And so when I thought about the word loyal, I'm going to actually tell you the definition of it because I think we can get it all mixed up sometimes. Loyal, the definition is giving or showing firm and constant support or allegiance to a person or institution. Now, when I think about the word constant, I don't normally think about my life and put those two words together because my life is not very constant. I don't know about yours, but mine is up and down a lot. And I'm sometimes at the whim of the relationships in my life. I'm at the whim of my hormones sometimes, just to be honest. I'm at the whim of the things that are happening in my life sometimes. I'm at the whim of my kids, what they need, my grandkids, what they need. I'm pulled in a lot of different directions. Can I get an amen? Okay, you're with me. Okay, so sometimes I don't feel like I'm very loyal. I'm not very constant and consistently supporting the things in my life that are important. Sometimes I am pulled to and fro by everything that comes along, which, as James says in the Bible, don't do that, right? He says, don't be pulled to and fro by everything that comes along. But if we aren't loyal to the things that God says to be loyal to, then we will let the rest of the world tell us what's important, right? And so what we're going to look at, and I think one way to look at this word loyal is to take the opposite of it. And I think if we take the opposite of it, disloyal, we'll see this in our lives a lot. So I'm going to give you some examples, and you see if the world as we exist is kind of disloyal in our world. So think about this. Disloyal, talking about others behind their backs. Do we see that? I mean, do we do that? So that might be a disloyalty. What about not supporting the authority in our lives? Like maybe our bosses? Do we ever do that? Are we ever disloyal in sometimes the way we deal with the authority in our lives? What about we get crossways with our spouse or our relationship, our major relationship, maybe daily, maybe hourly, maybe by the minute? Could that be disloyal? Is that disloyal? What about creating drama on Facebook? Nobody look around. Nobody look at anybody. What about creating drama in the church? What about not reading our Bible consistently, not praying consistently? Do we see that in our lives as somewhat of a disloyal? Can we see the things of the world kind of coming into and breaking into our world to make us disloyal? And so loyalty is a choice. Being loyal is a choice. So being consistent and supporting is a choice. And we have to decide in our lives, what are the things we're going to be loyal to? Or guess what? Somebody else will decide it for us, right? And so we're going to look tonight at Ruth. And we're going to look at what she did a little different than what the world kind of shows us in our lives and what the world kind of impresses on us. She's going to do it a little different. And so you saw in the video, you saw in that about what Ruth kind of did. I'm going to give you a little bit more background, okay? So basically, Naomi and Elimelech, okay, that was her husband's name, bless her heart. And so they're in our land. They believe in our God, okay? And they're Hebrew. They have a famine in the land, okay? So they go to another land, Moab. They go there in order to get food for their family. They have two little boys they got to provide, right? So they've got to, they're literally going to die if they don't get something. So they go to this other land. Now, this other land, the people there don't believe in our God. They have their own gods, okay? So they're in a pagan land, and they're having to live there and provide for their family. So their boys grow up, and their boys marry the Moabite women, okay? So they marry these women who do not believe in the same God that we believe in. And so those boys grow up, they marry these women, and then the father, Elimelech, he dies, and then the two boys, they're adults now, but they die. And so who's left is Naomi, Orpah, not Oprah, Orpah, and Ruth, okay? And so they're all to those three women together. Now, back in this day, women really couldn't provide for their families, okay? So the jobs and everything were given to the men, and the women took care of the children. And so there was no way for them to be able to provide for themselves in this particular environment in this village. And so what Naomi says is, she says, hey, Orpah, Ruth, y'all go back to your families, right? Go back to your Moabite homes. Go back where you know you'll be taken care of. I can't provide for you. So go back, be with them, and you will. They would have been with their gods, right? Okay? So makes sense, right? You don't have any way to provide for them. Y'all go back. So Orpah says, hey, yeah, see you later. Check out. Okay, she's gone. She goes back. But Ruth says, wait a minute. She says, I believe in your God. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to be loyal to you because you have brought God to me. I understand who he is because of you. And so I'm going to follow you. And she says, wherever you go, I will go. Okay? And I'll give you that scripture. It says Ruth 1:16 through 18. It's in your outline. You can look it up in your Bible. But it says, but Ruth replied, don't urge me to leave you. Now she's talking to Naomi, her mother-in-law, or turn back from you. Where you go, I will go. And where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me. Now, this chick is serious, right? That's some serious talk. Like, she's not just pretending. She's being loyal. She's being loyal to her mother-in-law. She's being loyal to her family now. And she's being loyal to the God that she's been introduced to our God. And she says, whatever happens, I'm going with you. I'm staying with you. And so this is huge. This is huge loyalty. And I wonder, for us, is there anything in our lives that we're that loyal over as Ruth was to say, hey, I am going to go, I'm going to be where you are, God. I'm going to be where you are. I'm not going to let anything distract me. I am going to be loyal, God, to what and where and who you have called me to. Interesting thought, isn't it? To think that somebody would be that passionately loyal. That is something that is not really seen in our community today. We're very, very distracted. And I want to ask you this in your life. Are you consistent in your walk with God? Do you have this kind of passion to say, you know what? I am going to go where God goes. I'm going to do what God asked me to do, and I'm going to be there. I'm going to be with God. Are you that loyal? Are you that consistent? Are you that passionate? I'm just going to be honest with you. It's very, very hard to be consistent today, isn't it? I mean, I come in and out and around and backwards and forwards. My life looks like this sometimes, like it's crazy. But are we willing to be loyal to what God has called us to do? And I have about three reasons why I think that we, well, not three reasons why. I think I have one reason why, three ways it's played out. But I have one reason why I think that we are very, very inconsistent today and not very loyal. And that is because we are distracted. We are distracted. As a community of believers, as women, we are distracted. And I want you to, if we're going to be like Ruth and we're going to have that passion and we're going to have that loyalty, there's a few things we're going to have to do. And the first one, this is on your outline, you can fill it in. I always want you to have something to take with you so you can look over it later. We have to choose calling over comfort. We have to choose calling over comfort. And see, Ruth was, could have been more comfortable staying with her Moabite family, right? She would have been more comfortable if she'd gone back to where she originally came from. She'd gone back to where she grew up. Think about, you know where you grew up, and you know the things about where you grew up, and you know the people there, and there's just a comfort there, right? She would have been more comfortable, more taken care of at that moment if she had gone back to where she came from. If she had taken Naomi's advice and just said, go. But what she did was she chose to be loyal. And it takes a choice to say, I'm going to be loyal to the God who has invested in me and called me. I'm going to be loyal to God instead of my comfort. And that's a real distraction. Our comfort is a distraction, right? But this is a calling, and we all have a calling. In Matthew 16:24, it says this. This is a New Testament reference if you need this. Ruth's Old Testament. If you need New Testament reference, this is New Testament. Then Jesus said to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. See, you have a cross in your life. I have a cross in my life. There are some comforts that I would like to have that don't go with the cross that Jesus has asked me to carry. And I don't know what that calling looks like in your life. I know that we're all called to make disciples. I know that. I know that's the Great Commission. We are all called to make disciples. So what that calling looks like in your life, I'm not really sure. I don't know who you're supposed to be talking to. I don't know who you're supposed to be sharing Jesus with, but that's a calling, and it trumps our comfort. It trumps me wanting to have friends that look like this. It trumps me wanting to have this relationship that I make the center of my life. I make it the biggest priority in my life. It trumps my children. I don't even want to say that out loud, but y'all, there is a calling that God has called us to make him known. And there's a way you're supposed to be doing that in your life. And you have to be loyal. We have to be loyal to that calling over our comfort. And sometimes our comfort will trip us up. I remember when I first got into ministry, and you know what? I didn't want to talk to anybody about Jesus because you know what? I was like, you know, I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. And like, gosh, if I talk to somebody about Jesus and if they just like didn't want to hear that and didn't want to receive that, like that would just make me feel really uncomfortable. And you know what? One day I was sitting there and I was talking to somebody and I was backing off and I was like, ah, I'm not really sure if I should say anything. And I heard it in my head. I didn't hear it audibly, but I heard it in my head, Jesus saying, really? You are going to take your comfort over what I've called you to do after all I've given you? And you know what? I was like, and I'd love to say that every time that I talk to somebody that I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm going to talk to them. But it's still kind of sometimes I'm like, what are they going to say? But you know what? I have a calling, and it trumps my comfort. And I have to be loyal to that calling God has called me to. And you do, too. You do, too. And I don't know what that looks like in your life. I know what it looks like for me because I've begged God to show me. But you know what? Have you begged God to show you how you're supposed to be living out your calling and then told him that you'll take calling over comfort? It's not easy, but it's so rewarding. It's so fulfilling when you can be loyal to that calling that God has put and placed on your life. Not only choosing calling over comfort, not only that, but also we have to choose reliance over reason. Do I have any reasoners in here? Like people that just reason out everything? I am one of those. I am one of those. I reason out everything, right? But reason to Ruth would have been what? Go home. Go home, girl. Like, go home where you're safe. Everybody would tell her the same thing. Reason, her own reason, would say, hey, I'm here where I can't provide for myself. I'm here where I have no future. I need to go back home where I'm taken care of. I'm safe. They'll love me. They'll take care of me. I'll have food. I'll eventually probably get remarried or something and have some kids, and I'll have a full life. That was reason. But you know what? Reliance on God is something different. Reliance on God. Reason only goes by what we can see with our own eyes. But reliance on God goes by what God can see with his eyes. So much more than what I can see with mine. Let's look at Proverbs 3, 5 through 6. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. How often are we reasoning out what we should do with our life with no thought to the reliance we should have on God, asking God, God, what do you want me to do with my life? See, I think that's where Ruth has it over on us, is she relied on God when it didn't make sense. Man, when's the last time that I looked at my life and went, God, this doesn't make sense, but I'm going to do it anyway because I'm relying on you to come through. No better place to be than to be relying on God instead of reasoning ourselves. And so number three, the third thing I think we have to do to get away from the distractions, first is calling over comfort, reliance over reason, and third is seek God's approval over others' opinion. Even Naomi told Ruth, go on home, girl. Get out of here. I love you, but you need to go back. Everybody in that day would have said, girl, go home. Do the safe thing. Be comfort. be comfortable there. You'll be taken care of. But see, they couldn't see the story that God could see. And what happens is that in Ruth's going back, in Ruth's staying with God, in Ruth's reliance on God, she marries Boaz, who then they have children. He brings Naomi in, her mother-in-law. He takes care of Naomi. He takes care of Ruth. They have children. And then you know what? She gets set up to be in the line, the lineage of David, and then eventually the lineage of Jesus. Now, I got chill bumps. If she had stayed and gone into Moab and stayed there with the gods and what was happening there, do you think she would be in the lineage of Jesus? No. See, God could see a picture that Ruth couldn't see. But only Ruth's loyalty got her to the place where God could make that happen in her life. So did she play a part? Absolutely. Her loyalty and her belief that God would take care of her, that she didn't have to reason it out, that she didn't have to go for her comfort, that she was going to go for the calling no matter whether she died, that's what got her to be in the genealogical line of Jesus. God can do so much more than we can do in our own reasoning and for our own comfort. Jeremiah 17, 5 through 9. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord. He is like a shrub in the desert and shall not see any good come. He shall dwell in the parched places of the wilderness in an uninhabited salt land. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord, is the Lord. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green and is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. You know, we've got lots of anxiety in the world today. Anybody here up at night anxious? Would you admit it? Whole room full of hands. Lots of fear, right? Lots of anxiousness, lots of anxiety, not sure what's going to happen tomorrow, the next day, next year. Did I make that mistake? Did I do that wrong? Should I be chasing this? Should I be chasing that? What if this happens? What if I can't pay that bill? But what if? What if the God of the universe is saying, honey, I've got you. All you have to do is put your hand in mine and let me do the work. All I'm asking you to do is to be loyal to what I've asked you to do. What if? What if we all slept better at night knowing and trusting that God is in control? He sees a picture that we can't see. You know that song that says, even when I don't see you, you're working? We've sang it here at the church over and over again. God, even when I don't see you, you're working. Girl, he is working in your life. Trust him. Be loyal. Be loyal to the calling that God has put on your life. If you don't know what it is, ask him. He has called you to make disciples somehow. He promises it. Ask him, how, God, how do you want me to make disciples? And then whatever he tells you, no matter what, it's not going to be in your comfort zone, no matter whether you think it's reason it out and it doesn't sound right, whatever it is, trust him in it. Because when you are loyal to him, he will move in mighty ways that we could never do on our own. And then we'd have a lot less anxiety and a lot less fear in our world. We'd be mighty warrior women, which is what he has called us to be. But it's through him that happens, not through us, not on our own. Let's bow our heads and let's pray together. Dear Lord God, thank you for letting us come tonight, God. Thank you for letting us be here with other women. Lord, we have some of the same struggles. We even have some of the same struggles that the women in your word had. But God, tonight, we lay those struggles at your feet. And God, we ask that you would help us to be loyal to you. God, let us look at situations and God, let us throw out our comfort and our reasoning and throw all those things away just like Ruth did so that we can chase after you loyally, God. Lord, I just pray that tonight you would reveal to us our stuck spots, reveal to us the places where we're not consistent in being loyal to you, reveal to us the places that need help, that we need your help. Lord, I pray that tonight we can walk away being women who are different, that we see the calling that you have on our life, and Lord, that we're willing to chase after you with all that we have. Lord, we love you, and we thank you so much for your son, Jesus, and for the opportunity to get to do what we do in our lives. God, tonight, teach us. Show us how to live. Show us how to be loyal to you so that someday we can see the picture that you see. But God, until then, we'll trust you. We'll trust you even when we can't see that you're working because we know that you are. Lord, we love you so much. We praise you. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.